Welcome to another video explaining the universe using the particle model. Well, today's video is about a vertical antenna, a question that was asked of me by a viewer quite a while ago. But first, I would like to go through and talk about our book. Yes, that's our logo for our book. You can see there's a small version of the double apple here. And it kind of refers to Newton, who used the apple to help define and gravity in the first place. And then in our book, we talk about a second level of gravity, which is smaller and faster. And that's why there's a smaller apple inside the larger apple. The theme of the book is the universe is not magic. You can buy our book on Amazon for $34.99, or you can buy an autographed copy from Dave and I for $35. And it will be available as an ebook in a few weeks. The name of the book is Principia Mathematica II, that's a spin-off of Newton's book. There was an introduction made on the book on August 21st, 2021 by David, and it was taped. You can watch that introduction by going to this link, and I'll put these two links in the description of this video so you can easily copy and go there. If you get a book, just read it. Don't worry about the details, especially if you're not really into physics. Some of the detail can bog you down. This is a story of nature. We give you the history of physics in the introduction, and then we give you more of our history. It's the story of nature, what it is and how it works. Read it and enjoy it. Well, I've been going through a list of words. A charge I went through recently. Semiconductors, is I did the diode and transistor, and now it's the antenna, and in particular, why a vertical antenna is recommended. And I will be going next time into reflections versus impedance. Okay, the viewer had asked a series of questions, but in this case, can you explain how a vertical radio sends radio waves, and then receiving antenna needs to be vertical and match wavelength? Well, I'm not going to do wavelength today. I'm just going to do the vertical antenna and how the radio waves are sent using the particle model. A little bit of background. When you transmit from an antenna, you can either go through the sky or a ground wave. Ground wave propagation is a method of radio frequency propagation that uses the area between the surface of the Earth and the ionosphere. The ground wave can propagate considerable distance over the Earth's surface, particularly in the low frequency and medium frequency, the LF-MF. Portion of the radio spectrum. Ground wave radio propagation is used to provide relatively local communications. Sky wave propagation uses the ionosphere, and it generally is sent in a vertical direction and bounces off the ionosphere and then bounces off the Earth, and it goes back and forth until it gets in. Of course, it can be used for much longer distance transmission of radio waves. But the vertical antenna, here's a link where I got this particular piece of information. This figure shows a vertical antenna, but the concept is the same for all antennas. The shaded area shows the most useful angles, 10 to 20 degrees. Here's the antenna itself is on a tower. You have a cable, coax cable usually going up to the antenna. You have the physical antenna, and he's saying, and I'm presuming they've measured this to some degree of accuracy, that the most effective area of transmission is in this area. Strange. Now, possibly this is also extended out here. Here he's using this as a reference point, but if you come up here, you might find that you've got more range than that. To get this angle of radiation, you need to have your antenna about 25 feet to 70 feet above the surface of the Earth to get that angle. That makes it seem quite limited, but when I talk about the antenna with the particle model, you'll see that there's more range here than just the 10 to 20 degrees, but that may be, because I'm not an expert here, that may be the most effective range. Yeah, well, this is my view of the same antenna. We got G1 streams of particles in this form coming from the radio. It is a pulsating DC. It's not an AC signal. It's a pulsating DC. In fact, the DC portion is down here, and that portion gets blocked when you go through the capacitor. So this is the form you see going into the capacitor. The form coming out is just this top part, just the top part. I've assumed here for the moment that the peak is 100 G1 particles, and the valley is zero. And so you start here at 50 G1s, and you increase the number, and then to get to 100, then you decrease it to 50, down through 25 to 0, up to 25 to 50. And this is what I call pulsating DC. This is not alternating, nothing going back and forth here. There's no negative, no positive. It's just straightforward G1 particles flowing at speed C into the antenna, and as they go through the antenna, most of them go through. Most of them go out the end, but some of them will hit and scatter. That all depends on the construction of the antenna. The more resistive, if you will, if this gets more resistive, there'll be more scattering, and hence more G1 streams going out in all kinds of directions, including the ones I just showed in the previous slide. Now, here's some information about vertical versus horizontal. You will have to decide whether the antenna will be vertical or horizontal. The exact orientation is not critical. In fact, even if it runs at 45 degree angle, the difference will be barely noticeable. And in fact, if it is at a 45 degree angle, it will function as both vertical and horizontal antenna. This is important because the two antennas involved in the communication, yours and that of the person you are talking to, should be oriented the same way to get the optimal reception, transmission from yours and reception of theirs. Either both of them should be vertical or both of them should be horizontal. And you can see the physical relationship there. We'll look at the vertical one in a bit. If one of them is vertical and the other one is horizontal, there will be a fairly significant decline in performance. For example, if you've got the waves going, the G1 streams going this way, and your horizontal antenna is horizontal, then you're going to only catch one of these waves. You're going to miss all of them. If it's vertical, you can catch all of them. That's the main point right there. If you're vertical, you can catch all of them since they're coming at you horizontally. So, if the antennas work at all, why bother matching? Why bother? And that is to maximize the number of G1 streams received. So, this is simplified. We have a radio station here. Battery or power supply generates to power it, and it also generates the G1 streams up the tower to the antenna, and they go out in all directions. And the one that goes for the group that goes from here to here is going to be the most effective in receiving the signal. And line of sight is kind of important, although radio waves can go through buildings, but they will get can get blocked, attenuated significantly. But here you can see why a vertical antenna sending a signal this way, these are individual streams of light coming, about light of radio waves coming through, hitting the antenna, and you'll get maximum reception if it's vertical to catch these horizontal streams. Now, here's an interesting point about the ground wave, and I got this from this link. The radio signal spreads out from the transmitter along the surface of the Earth. This is the standard explanation. Instead of just traveling in a straight line, the radio signals tend to follow the curvature of the Earth. Well, why is that? Well, this is because currents are induced in the surface of the Earth, and this action slows down the wavefront. Well, that's a statement. I highlighted in red. I didn't find an answer to that, why it slows down. But when it slows down, causing the wavefront of the radio communications to tilt downwards towards the Earth. Tilt is an interesting word, but there's no physical explanation of why the tilting and the slowing or the slowing down. With the ray front tilted in this direction, it can curve around the Earth and be received well beyond the horizon, which is really the main point here. You're transmitting here, and you're receiving after you go past the vertical. The line of sight would take it way up here, but somehow you're able to, this tower receives it because it follows the path of the Earth. Well, they don't explain why, but particle model has its answer. This is the same drawing I just showed you. Instead of traveling in a straight line, the radio signals tend, that's what they said in that text, all objects have a G2 gravity field and a G1 gravity field surrounding them. We know that G2 gravity is the force that bends the light as it goes into a prism. It's the force that bends the light that came around the sun during an eclipse that Sir Arthur Eddington measured. That's our position. It's G2 gravity that causes light to bend. And as a consequence, the G2 gravity force is strongest here at the surface, or should be very strong, and hence would cause the light to bend. It's a very clear a mechanism that the G2 gravity does in many applications. It also bends G1 streams around and through a magnet. Quite remarkable with the number of things that the G2 gravity does. Well, my next video will be on reflections versus impedance. I hope to talk about wavelength and possibly resonance, although I'm not sure about that. So, but the next one should be on reflections and impedance. My name is Bob DeHilster, and I am your particle model guru. If you have a question, ask Particle. I will respond. You can send me an email at particleguru@gmail.com or comment in the comment area of this video. Thank you for your attention.